What about collections or charge-offs? How can those be handled to increase your credit?
Probably one of the biggest myths that's out there, and we talked several shows ago on our myth show about mortgages and credit, is people think if I have an old collection from a year, 2, 5 years ago, I'll just go pay it off when I get the money and my credit will go back up. That's absolutely incorrect, 100% false. It will actually lower your credit to go pay off an old collection just simply by doing that. But what you want to do is something called a pay for deletion. The only way to increase your credit by paying off a collection or charge off is to do a pay for deletion. You can look up additional information online about it. They're everywhere. You need to get a letter from the creditor before you pay that says, if this person pays X amount on this account, we will consider it paid in full and we will report a deletion, or we will delete the account from the credit bureau. When it's deleted, it's completely gone. It's erased. It will never show up again. You need to get that letter, though, from them, because a lot of these collection agencies are unscrupulous and even borderline fraudulent, and they'll tell you anything over the phone to get you to pay them. But if you get that letter, okay, and then you can prove that you paid them that money with a debit from your bank account, check, credit card, etc. Now, if they don't pony up and actually delete that account, you can show that to the credit bureau and get the credit bureau to step in and delete it. That's the only way, because if you don't do that, what's going to happen is you go and pay an account and you don't get them to delete it. It's going to reactivate that account. Even though it'll show a zero balance, it's going to take a DLA, which stands for date of last activity. The older that date of last activity is, the higher your credit's going to be. So if you have an account that's a date of last activity from 5 years ago, and you go and pay that account today and it's not deleted, it's going to reactivate the date of last activity to current, and it's actually going to drop your credit score, sometimes very significantly.
Wow. What about filing bankruptcy?
I mean, bankruptcy is probably one of the worst things you can do for your credit. So we want to concentrate on things that are going to help people.
No, but let's
credit.
Say somebody filed bankruptcy 10 years ago, 15 years ago even.
That's not going to really affect them as much. I mean, mortgage programs do have seasoning requirements for bankruptcy foreclosure. So you can't just file bankruptcy on a Monday and go get a mortgage the next day or the next month.
No, of course not.
After a couple of years, depending on the loan program, anywhere typically from 2 to 7 years, depending on the type of bankruptcy and the type of mortgage you're trying to get, it won't factor in anymore after that time. It will affect your credit, in my understanding, and from what I've seen reviewing thousands of credit reports in my career, I've seen bankruptcy and the repercussions of bankruptcy, all the missed payments, etc., that are typically associated with bankruptcy, that can affect you for several years. I would expect at least 2 to 3 years, you know, after the bankruptcy, that you will see that still affecting your credit. But it won't factor in with getting a mortgage once you meet those program guidelines. You'll want to check with your mortgage advisor and loan officer to say, hey, I filed bankruptcy on this date, or my bankruptcy was discharged on this date. It was a Chapter 7, Chapter 13. There's all different guidelines, and here is when you can get a mortgage. Here's when you can apply for the mortgage. So that's really important. Now, there are certain exceptions called extenuating circumstances. If you had a catastrophe scenario and had to file bankruptcy for a medical reason, etc., those are very hard to prove, but in those cases there can be exceptions granted to get you a mortgage before those waiting periods.
Typically, Rob, how long does it take to change or, you know, improve your credit?
So if you pay off a credit card, like we were talking about earlier, to pay it down to these lower thresholds, it's not going to report tomorrow. The real number is, if you look at your credit card statement and look at the statement end date, typically the creditor is going to report the day after that. So on every single credit card, it's not your due date. You need to look at your statement and look for something that says statement end date. It's going to be the last date of that actual statement pulling in transaction. So if the statement end date is May 17th, then typically around May 18th, is when they're going to re-report. So that's the exact answer if you want to get technical, but every credit card is going to have a different statement end date. So my rule of thumb with my clients is, especially if you're paying down multiple accounts, 3 to 4 weeks is the minimum amount of time from when you pay it to when you can expect that it will actually report to the three credit bureaus.
Okay. If somebody has a low score, should they even talk to a lender?
I'd say the lower the score is, the more advice you need from a lender.
Yeah.
Because you're not a credit expert. You don't do this every day.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not a credit repair company. Everything we're talking about is just for educational purposes. And I'm going off, again, thousands of credit reports reviewed. But I can tell you that when someone comes to me, even with a credit score, believe it or not, in the 400s or the low 500s, I can look at their report and very quickly tell them which of these four strategies we talked about,
mm-hmm.
or even five if you include the pay for deletions on collections, that they can implement right away and get their credit to where it needs to be. So you want to get with a lender, no matter what your credit score is, at least to do a fact find.
Yeah, not necessarily file paperwork, but at least
just to
get
say, hey, I want to get a house in a year. I want to refinance in the future. Where do I need to be? I have no idea where I'm at now. Credit Karma says I'm X score. Where am I? What do I need to do?
Well, sadly, Rob, most people don't know that unless they're hearing that now. They only contact their lender when they're ready for a mortgage, when they're ready to buy.
Right.
But if somebody has a cosigner, you touched upon this a little while ago. If somebody has a cosigner with a good score, would that help them?
Unfortunately, a good credit score on a cosigner won't help you because mortgage lenders look at the lower of the credit scores.
Oh.
So when it comes to credit, a cosigner is not going to help you. Where they will help you is when it comes to your debt to income and getting qualified for the mortgage from an income standpoint and a debt standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
That's where it can pay off. But if you have a cosigner that's a 750 score and your score is a 610, the underwriter, the loan officer, everyone involved in the process, they're going to put aside the score of the higher person, the cosigner. They're going to be looking at the lower. And if your score is too low to get a mortgage, then it doesn't matter how many cosigners you have. You can't be on that mortgage. You may need to work out something else or be creative, but there's no way you're going to be on there with a low score and a cosigner with a high one.
I would imagine that's more relevant with young adults, people in their early 20s or 19 even, 19, 20, when they haven't really been in the workforce a long time. Maybe they don't have much of a credit score. Not necessarily a bad credit score. They just haven't been in the workforce consistently for a long period of time. And they're certainly not at the top of their pay scale at that age.
But that's why it's so important to start building this credit early. If you're a parent, instill this in your children. Add them as authorized users when they're in their teens to your credit card. That'll help start mm-hmm. building their score. When they turn 18, get them, even if it's a secured card, get them something to start managing money, to start building that score.
Let me just add one thing to that, parent. If you are going to do that, make sure you have a long, serious discussion with your child and teach them responsible, how to be responsible and what responsibility is great responsibility is part of owning a credit card.
You don't need to even give them a card. One of the great things about an authorized user is that they may send a card to you. You can just rip it up. You can throw it out. You don't need to give it to them. Okay? So you can add them. They're going to be able to piggyback, so to speak, on your positive history. I would add to what you said, make sure the card that you're adding them to has a long-standing track record of positive payments. You don't want to add somebody to a card like we were talking about that's maxed out, that's got a very high utilization.
Of course not. Great information. Folks, if you've got any questions, maybe you want to have it asked on this show, we'd love to have your question answered right on these airwaves. You just simply email mortgagemattersradioshow@gmail.com. Again, mortgagemattersradioshow@gmail.com. If you are interested in this topic or any other that we've discussed in the past, you got to check out the website, www.robgw.com. Once again, it's robgw.com. And if you would like to make an appointment or just have a couple of questions you'd like to have Rob answer for you, even if it's just over the phone, simply jot this number down and give him a call. Give him a call right away. 860-413-3938. Once again, 860-413-3938. For Rob Weinberg, I'm Gary Byron. Thank you so much for listening. Until next Saturday, have a good one, everybody. So long.